Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bad Ghosts Club by Danielle Garrett. Narrated by Amanda Ronconi. Chapter 1. I can't believe it's almost Halloween, I said, working to untangle a string of small pumpkin-shaped lights. It feels like we were just putting these away for the season. Someone definitely has their thumb on the fast-forward button of life. Lizzie laughed as she set a trio of ceramic pumpkins beside the cash register. That's because you were lost in wedding planning land for most of it. Smiling, I nodded in agreement. That's true. It's actually our one-month anniversary tomorrow. Aw, do they have some kind of gift guide for the first month? You know, like how the first year is paper. Working from left to right, I strung the tiny pumpkins along the edge of the front counter, tacking the strand of wire in place with clear tape between each plastic pumpkin. I don't know about that, but we are supposed to go pick up our wedding album from our photographers, so that has to count. I can't wait to see it. Here, I said, handing Lizzie the plug when I reached the end of the counter. She plugged in the lights and the pumpkins illuminated, each of their painted expressions backlit by a soft orange light. Cute! I reached into the bottom of the storage box and quickly recoiled with a startled yelp. What is it? Frowning, I pushed the box away. It looks like we have more than just plastic spiders in here, and now I'm not sure which of the cobweb balls are the real deal. Oh, it's wigging me out. Lizzie cringed and took the box to the back room. A few seconds later, I heard her bang the box against the large metal trash can we used for flower waste. She reappeared a few moments later, wiping her hands on her apron. I'll hose it out before we repack it. Bless you, I exhaled. She giggled and went back to unpacking the second box of decorations. We added a scarecrow to the front door, a variety of pumpkins to the window display, and lastly hung a thin metal cutout in the shape of a witch astride a broomstick on the wall behind the register. Nice to see you again, Broomhilda, Lizzie said, smiling at the painted witch. We'd bestowed the name upon the decoration the year before, possibly after one too many spiked apple ciders. When the last of the decorations were set out, I took a slow twirl, admiring our handiwork. There were moments when it still caught me off guard that the flower and gift shop was all mine, every detail pulled from my daydreams. My smile faltered a little as I wondered if this would be the last time I got the place ready for Halloween. You okay over there? Lizzie asked. Did we miss a spot? Turning back to face my sole employee, I hitched the corners of my smile back in place. It looks great. I guess I should go upstairs and finish packing. Are you sure you have everything you need? Yes, for the 100th time, yes, Lizzie replied, laughing as she made a shooing gesture at me. I promise not to burn the shop down. Empty the till into my purse and run away to Mexico, and I will water all of the plants. I sighed. She was smiling and clearly not bothered by my barrage of questions, but I couldn't help but feel a nip of guilt. I'm sorry. You know I trust you with my whole heart, right? Because I do. You're just stressed. Anyone would be, considering what you've got going on. You're the best. I gave her a quick embrace. Over the past couple of years, we'd become friends, in addition to our employer-employee relationship. Lizzie had my back, both at the shop and outside it. Thank you, I said. The bell on the front door twinkled and a trio of middle-aged ladies wandered into the store. With summer in the rearview mirror, it was no longer the peak of tourist season in the small coastal town of Beechwood Harbor, but this weekend there was a wine festival a couple towns over, and our little community was experiencing a slight surge in visitors as people passed through on their way to and from the event. Lizzie greeted the women with a friendly smile, and I placed a hand on her shoulder. I'm going to head upstairs and finish packing. She nodded, then rounded the front counter to go strike up a conversation about the various gift items in the front window display. I took the back stairs up to the small apartment built above the retail space. When I'd originally viewed the property, I'd agreed to lease the apartment, too, thinking it would serve as a temporary crash pad while I built my business. However, a lot had changed since my move to the small coastal town a few years ago. For starters, I'd met and married my husband, Lucas Green. There was some irony in getting a new last name before a new address. In the whirlwind of acclimating to life in a new town, starting my own business, falling in love, and getting married, I hadn't given house hunting more than a cursory glance through the rental listings in the local paper every few months. All of that changed after Lucas and I exchanged our I do's. We were now knee-deep in the house hunting process, only not in Beechwood Harbor. Lucas's job was in Seattle. He had a plush corporate rental, courtesy of his job with a high-end security firm, but it was more of a crash pad. It wasn't meant to be permanent, and certainly wasn't the kind of place we envisioned spending our newlywed years. We'd started the house hunt prior to the wedding, but nothing had worked out yet. So, I spent my time ping-ponging between the big city and the quiet small town. I was beginning to feel like I had a split personality. There was Beechwood Harbor Scarlet, working at Lily Pond and keeping up my personal relationships. Then there was Seattle Scarlet, the newlywed bride trying to soak up every minute with her husband, wishing life came equipped with a pause button. On top of all that, there were the ghosts. Several months back, I'd handed over the reins of the ghost support group I'd formed since arriving in town. My ghost friend and longtime Beechwood resident, Gwen, ran the show these days. I like to stop in and socialize when possible, but beyond that, I'd managed to unentangle myself from most of the ghostly goings-on around town. Granted, my three permanent companions came up with more than enough to keep me occupied. Hayward Kensington III was still in the throes of a post-death identity crisis, trying to decide what the future held for him. This exploration rubbed up against Gwen, Hayward's lady love. Then there was Flapjack. The Himalayan ghost cat had one potent superpower, unending snark. They were exhausting and entertaining and infuriating all at once. In other words, they were family. My family. I found the trio in the living room, sitting on the couch, watching whatever channel I'd left playing before going downstairs to work that morning.
"Good afternoon, Lady Scarlet,"
Hayward greeted, tapping his fingers to the brim of the top hat perched on his head. "Hey, Scarlet," Gwen added. The pair couldn't be more different if they tried. Hayward was an old-world gentleman who died following a performance at the Vienna Opera House. Dressed in white tie, he'd been giving the performance a standing ovation when he tumbled from the balcony seats. Then there was Gwen, a flower child, barely out of her teen years when she died in a tragic stage-diving accident at an outdoor concert. Perhaps that was the thread that held them together. Both died in musical events. In any case, Gwen's feather earrings, Farrah Fawcett waves, and floral print romper were in stark contrast to Hayward's coattails, bristled mustache, top hat, and gloves.
"Finally," Flapjack said, vaulting himself up onto the kitchen counter. "You've been gone forever."
I frowned at him. "I've been downstairs all morning. Don't tell me you're developing separation anxiety after 20-something years."
"Hardly," Flapjack scoffed. "I'm just sick of this channel. I'd also like some tuna. You owe me, remember?"
I rolled my eyes. A few days ago, I'd struck a bargain with the feline, trading him access to a can of tuna in exchange for his tamping down the rude comments about Hayward's new hobby, opera singing. In an effort to connect with Gwen and find more common interests, Hayward had taken his lady love to the theater the last few weekends I'd gone to Seattle. Somewhere along the way, he'd met the ghost of a once-famous opera singer and had started taking lessons. It was good for Hayward's soul, not so good for our collective eardrums. "I don't have time for that now," I told the cat. "I have an hour before I need to leave, and I haven't finished packing." Flapjack's silver eyes gleamed as he looked at Hayward.
"You know, Hayward, there's something I've been meaning to say."
"Flapjack?" I growled. The cat flicked his tail toward the drawer where I kept the can opener.
his eyes narrowed in challenge. "This is why they tell you not to negotiate with terrorists," I mumbled, stalking into the kitchen. Once the fluffy tyrant had his treat, I crossed through the living room, heading toward the small bathroom. "As I was saying, I'm leaving in an hour. Are either of you planning on coming with?" I hit the bathroom lights, and Gwen materialized on the counter beside the sink, her mile-long legs swinging back and forth. I clutched at my chest. "Jeez, Gwen, you scared me. Sorry." Exhaling, I started plucking items from the counter. I'd purchased duplicates of most things, one set to keep at Lucas's rental and one to keep here, to make packing easier. But there were a few key items I hadn't wanted to buy again. My perfume, flat iron, glasses to wear at night after taking out my contact lenses. "Remember, I won't be coming back until Wednesday," I said, dumping the items into a small travel bag I kept under the sink. "We're coming," she nodded. "Hayward has big plans for us." I laughed. "Oh, yeah? Something tells me you're not thrilled about them." Gwen looked away for a moment, worrying at her lower lip. "I'm sure it will be a fine time. I just hope it's not another foreign opera. The music is always beautiful, but I sure would like it better if I could understand what they were singing about." I tucked away my smile. "Just remember, this journey you two are on isn't supposed to be one-sided. If you go to the opera with him, he needs to hold up his end of the deal and do something you want to do." "I know." A spark of a grin pulled at her lips. "I'm making him go to the wall of gum." "Oh, Gwen, you're not serious," I grimaced. She giggled. "Why not? It's something new." "Blech." I killed the lights and went down the short hall into the singular bedroom. My suitcase was already opened, lying across the bed. I'd started packing that morning, before going downstairs to open the shop for the day. Having spent more weekends away than at home the past few months, the packing was something I could do on autopilot. Gwen floated in behind me and settled at the foot of the bed. "I'll bet you'll be glad when all this traveling is over, huh?" she said, glancing at my suitcase. Tucking the toiletries bag beside a stack of light sweaters, I smiled at the part she wasn't saying. "Don't worry, there's no danger of that being over anytime soon. I still don't have any buyers lined up to take over the shop. So even when Lucas and I find a place, I'll be back and forth." "It's not going to be the same, though." I smiled, trying to tamp down the bittersweet pang in my chest. "I know." Gwen fell silent for a few minutes, watching me as I finished packing the last few items and zipped up the suitcase. "I guess I'd better go get Hayward. Meet you downstairs. See you there." Driving 3 hours into the city was so routine, I could do most of it on cruise control. In a perfect world, I could listen to an audiobook or one of my favorite playlists. However, in my world, I had three bickering ghosts in the back seat and would have gladly traded them in for a trio of toddlers. At least the toddlers would have eventually fallen asleep. Hayward insisted on warming up his vocals, which led to Flapjack completely foregoing our arrangement to lay off the mockery, and Gwen sat in between, trying to play interference as Hayward sang louder and Flapjack started caterwauling. They finally piped down after I threatened to chuck a handful of ghost dust into the back seat. But even then, they threw little barbed remarks at one another for the rest of the drive. When we finally arrived at the high-rise condo building, every last one of my nerves was shot. Lucas met me in the lobby with a cup of coffee and a warm smile. "Please tell me there's alcohol in here," I said, taking the cup. Lucas chuckled as he leaned in for a kiss. "Guess that answers my first question." He took the handle of the suitcase and rolled it toward the bank of elevators. "I'm assuming you've got the full entourage in tow?" He glanced past my shoulder, though he couldn't see the ghosts. Or hear them. Lucky bastard. A ping sounded, and a pair of silver doors slid open. A well-dressed couple departed, and then Lucas ushered me inside. "At least the rain held off for most of the drive," I said, hitching my purse a little higher on my shoulder as I stepped aboard the elevator. Lucas dragged the suitcase in behind him, and the door slid closed. Hayward and Gwen stood opposite Flapjack, the three of them scowling.
"Perhaps we need to come up with a proper schedule," Hayward suggested. Lady Gwen and I could accompany Lady Scarlet into the city every other weekend. Then you, Flapjack, could have her to yourself on the opposite weeks.
I rolled my eyes. This isn't a custody agreement. I get the final say, and if the three of you can't behave yourselves, then none of you will be invited next time. Lucas cringed.
That bad, huh?
I sipped the hot mocha. You have no idea.
Sorry.
The trio sulked all the way up to Lucas's floor. Part of me wanted to send them away, but thought better of it and decided to just ignore them as best I could until they got bored and went off on their own adventures. Lucas rolled my suitcase into the bedroom and helped me unpack. My visit would be a little longer this time, and it felt nice to have my things hanging in the closet and properly laid out on the bathroom counter. We caught up with each other as we made quick work of the unpacking. The ghosts stayed out of sight, adhering to the rule I'd laid down about interrupting Lucas and me when we were alone in the bedroom, for obvious reasons. Sighing, I flopped back on the bed. It was 10 times more comfortable than the bargain basement model I had back in Beechwood Harbor. Are you sure we even have to buy a house? I mean, what's so wrong with this place? Lucas chuckled and stretched out beside me.
I already got the name of the mattress and have one on layaway for whenever we move into our new place.
I laughed. You know me so well. He scooped me in close, and we let our lips do a little catching up, too. When we managed to get untangled, Lucas sat up and brushed a hand over his short hair. He'd served in the Navy in his 20s and still preferred to keep his hair cut short.
If you're up for it, there's actually an open house tonight, he said,
twisting around to look back at me. My nose wrinkled. It's almost 5 o'clock.
It just went on the market, and the sellers are highly motivated. They're showing it tonight and all day tomorrow, but Yvonne said it's likely to turn into a bidding war, so if we want a crack at it, we should try to make it ASAP.
Another bidding war? I groaned, rolling out of bed. I know,
but Scar, this place, I'm telling you, it could be a real contender,
Lucas said, following me back into the main living area. Is it a house? I asked, ignoring the way the ghosts perked up.
2-story, single family in Georgetown. The yard is a little small, but there is a little deck out back for grilling and entertaining. The kitchen was recently remodeled, and the master bath has a soaking tub, which I know was on your wish list.
Oh, a yard, Gwen gushed. Maybe you can get a dog, Flapjack hissed. A bubble of excitement threatened to rise, but I quickly stuffed it back down. We'd been here before. The trail behind us was littered with false starts, rejected offers, failed inspections, and blown deals. Following our honeymoon in Hawaii, we'd returned to the mainland just in time to offer on a gorgeous townhome, only to have the deal fall apart a week and a half later when the seller reconsidered and yanked the property right out from underneath us. We can go see it, but remember our deal.
I promise to wear my best poker face,
Lucas agreed with a grin. All right, but I'm still not going to get excited until the keys are actually in my hands.
Something will work out, Lucas told me.
I don't see why we can't just keep this place, Flapjack said, stalking along the wall of windows at the far side of the living room.
It's big enough.
Not if they want to have a baby, Gwen said. Flapjack made a sound that was reminiscent of his hairball hacking days. I laughed. We won't need to worry about that for a while. Lucas glanced back at me, his expression puzzled. Oh, oops, sorry. I waved a hand toward Gwen. Ghosts.
Aha.
Lucas grinned at me, coming a little closer.
You know, we could leave in half an hour and still make it to the open house. We could let traffic die down a little.
His grin turned decidedly wicked, and I raised a hand, pointing at the front door. Ghosts out. Chapter 2. The house was exactly as Lucas described, a perfect starter home in an established neighborhood. The only problem was that the other half a dozen families, mostly couples, touring the place thought so too. I heard more than a handful of excited oohs and did you see that walk-in closet comments as we walked through. We finished our self-guided tour and stepped out onto the back deck.
The yard was small, but appeared well-kept and low-maintenance. A drizzle of rain pattered against the cover stretching over the deck. I could easily picture curling up on an outdoor love seat with a cozy blanket and a good book, escaping from the world for a little while. "So," Lucas began, slipping his hands into the pockets of his jeans. "What do you think? Should we put in an offer?" I glanced over my shoulder, back through the open French doors. "There are a lot of people here. Do you really think we have a chance at getting it?" Lucas shrugged.
"We won't know if we don't try. For the price and the location, I think it's worth risking another letdown. We could actually go a little bit over and still fall within our approved range."
I chewed at my lower lip, mulling it over. The hosting agent, a curly-haired woman, poked her head out and asked if we had any questions. Lucas asked a couple of questions about the utilities. I drifted off, distracted as Flapjack slipped through the wall to Lucas's left and took a lap around the deck, his tail swishing. When the three ghosts realized we were going to an open house, they insisted on tagging along. Lucas and the agent finished their conversation and she ducked back into the house, scurrying off to talk to another young couple who were inspecting the kitchen. "Well," I said, glancing down, "what do you think, Flapjack? Does it get your illustrious stamp of approval?" Lucas frowned.
"Does the cat really get a vote here?"
Smiling, I cupped a hand in front of my mouth.
"No, but he gets cranky if we don't at least pretend."
Flapjack turned his back on us, his tail swishing faster.
"I was going to offer some advice, but if that's how you want to play things, you're on your own."
"What advice? When did you find the time to get your real estate license? What with all the channel surfing and begging, your schedule is pretty booked."
Lucas chuckled.
Flapjack craned around to look up at me, his silver eyes glowing.
"I wouldn't get your hopes up. That agent in there isn't playing it straight with you."
My smile melted. "What do you mean?"
"She's driving up the price, getting people to offer higher and higher. Probably gets herself a bigger piece of the pie that way."
"Are you serious?"
I groaned.
"What? What is it?"
Lucas asked.
"The agent is whipping up a bidding war,"
I replied, keeping my voice soft to avoid attracting the attention of the other couple that wandered out to check the backyard.
"There's your competition, Scar."
Flapjack looked up at the newcomers.
"They just agreed to 30K over asking."
I blinked. 30K?
Flapjack twitched the tip of his tail. The couple offered us polite smiles, but didn't say anything as they stepped off the deck onto the small paver steps that wrapped around to the backyard gate. The woman missed a step and nearly tumbled to the ground. Her partner helped her get steady and then tucked an arm around her waist as they continued on.
"So sorry to interrupt, but I wanted to make sure you had my card before you left."
I twisted around just as the agent extended a glossy business card to Lucas. She caught my eye and smiled.
"Did you have any other questions for me?"
"It sounds like there are already a few offers on the table, is that right?" I asked. The woman clasped her hands together and offered a warm smile.
"That's correct. We've had a lot of interest in this property. Surely you can see why. But that doesn't mean it's a done deal. The seller is considering all offers. They're expected to make a decision after tomorrow's showings."
Lucas draped an arm over my shoulders.
"I think we'll have to pass. It sounds like it's going to get pushed up past our ceiling."
"Oh? What were you pre-approved for? Maybe I have something else that might work better. Do you have an agent?"
"It's not the pre-approval that's the problem," Lucas replied. "It's more of where we want to land, number-wise."
"I see."
The woman pulled a sympathetic frown. Lucas and I exchanged a quick glance before he cleared his throat.
"We appreciate the help, Miss..."
"Oh, please call me Fran,"
she interjected, her smile firmly back in place.
"Listen, I probably shouldn't be saying this, but between you and me, I think you two have the best chance at this place. With a teensy push, this house could be yours."
"A teensy push? What does that mean?" I asked. Fran smiled down at her hands, her attention fixated on a gold ring. It was bulky in comparison to the other jewelry she wore, more of a class ring than a fashion accessory.
"The top offer is over asking, it's true, But if you were to go a little further, say 40,000, I could almost guarantee you'd come out the winners.
40,000 over asking? I sputtered.
I understand your concern, Fran said, her smile growing wider, displaying pearly teeth. It sounds like a lot, but it would only add a couple hundred to your monthly payment. And a property like this is well worth it. Wouldn't you agree?
I tugged on Lucas's arm. I'm sorry, we're not interested. Come on, babe. Fran took a swift sidestep, blocking the doorway back into the house. She tapped a finger on the gold ring, and something in her eyes changed. A golden ring showed around her pupils.
Hear me out, she said, her tone low and soothing, as though she were talking to a baby. We can make this work.
No, we can't, I replied forcefully. Wheeling around, I meant to cut the same exit the other couple had, through the side yard to the gate. But when I tugged on Lucas's arm, he didn't budge. Lucas, are you...
Scar, let's see what she has to say,
he said, his tone quiet and soft like Fran's.
Should I get the paperwork?
Fran asked.
Yes.
Lucas nodded slowly.
That sounds like a good idea.
Lucas! I yanked harder on his arm. He remained frozen solid. Flapjack, help!
What do you want me to do? He asked grumpily. I don't even have opposable thumbs.
Oh, yeah. And then there's that whole I'm dead thing, too.
We don't need any help, Fran told me,
her gold eyes sparkling as she shifted her gaze away from Lucas.
Everything is fine.
Scarlet, are you out here? My heart surged at the friendly voice. Gwen, help! Gwen sliced through Fran. The jolt was enough to knock Fran out of her trance-like state. She shuddered as she whipped around, trying to find the source of the sensation. Scarlet, what is it? What's wrong? Gwen asked, whirling back and forth, trying to identify the source of the panic. The temporary interruption was enough to throw off the glow of magic in the agent's eyes. Lucas blinked a few times before reaching up to pinch the bridge of his nose.
Who are you?
What are you? Fran stammered. I lifted a finger, stopping just short of jabbing it into the woman's chest. I'm calling the SPA and turning you in, so I hope you get a really good price for this house because it's the last one you'll ever sell.
Now, we don't need to escalate things to that level. Come on, we can work something out.
Fran gave a nervous laugh and turned to glance over her shoulder, back into the house, where half a dozen other attendees were still milling about. Throwing a false smile, she turned back to me, leaning in close.
I can make this deal happen for you. At asking price. Not a penny above. I'll even have my clients throw in for the closing costs. Please, let's be reasonable here.
Lucas still looked like he was fighting off an ice cream headache.
What just happened?
She was using some kind of magic to trick us. I may not know much about magic, but I know that mind magic is highly illegal. Gwen gasped. That's horrible! If Fran could see the ghosts, she didn't let on.
I can help you, and I promise not to do it anymore. Scout's honor.
Take the deal, Scar. Who's she really hurting?
Flapjack said.
See if she'll throw in a case of halibut or something, too, will ya?
Flapjack! Gwen snapped, saving me the trouble of scolding the morally compromised feline. I'm calling the SPA, I told Fran. They need to know what's going on here.
Fran's expression twisted, her teeth bared as a snarl ripped from her.
Suddenly, she lunged for me, her French-tipped acrylics heading straight for my throat. What she hadn't counted on was the fact that I was accompanied by a professionally trained bodyguard-slash-veteran-slash-husband. Lucas had her restrained before I could even suck in a full breath. He yanked her wrists together, spun her to face the wall.
That's enough, he barked. Now do I have to keep hold of you, or can you keep your hands to yourself?
Fran swore loudly.
Wasn't much of an answer, Lucas replied,
but he released her anyway. He kept himself firmly planted between me and Fran, every muscle in his body set on edge, ready to react if needed.
The scene had captured the attention of the other open house attendants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.